Sunday we're going to do something a little different. We're going to talk about the call ministry. They have asked that churches this day across our county do what's called a Stand Sunday, in standing for those who are orphaned and those who are without family. And in our church, we're so blessed. We have a couple of different families that are working with foster kids in our church. And one of those families we're going to sort of feature this morning, and it's Bill and Christy Higgins. Now, Christy is upstairs. Is Bill upstairs? Mm-hmm. No. No, Christy
just
went.
Working.
No. so we're missing Bill today, but Bill and Christy, was it this past Friday, Christy? Mm-hmm. They have a couple of young men who they are foster caring for in their home. And I know one of their names. One of their names is Josh. What's the other little boy's name?
It's Malachi.
Josh and Malachi. So Josh and Malachi are up in the, they're upstairs in the balcony, and they are here with them. So everybody wave at Josh and Malachi. Yay!
Josh and Malachi.
And there are several people throughout our county that are doing foster care, helping out with foster care. There's so many ways that we as a church body can help the call ministry. It's one of those ministries that you never can do enough. And we have searched to find ways that we can help in more ways than just giving. Now, this church gives $100 a month to the call ministry every month to help them financially. But there's a lot of ways that you can help. You can prepare meals for foster families, and you can take them a meal every so often. You can help with child care. You know, every so often a family will take in children, and they'll either have children of their own. Of course, it's a married couple, and so they need a night out away from kids. All of those in this room who have kids would say amen to that. You need a night out every once in a while. I said you need a night out every once in a while without kids. Amen. And so you can help out by helping them with some child care during the week. There are dozens of ways for us to help as a church body. But one thing that they have asked us to do is they have asked us to pray. To pray for all of those families that have children in the home that they are foster caring for. I don't have all the statistics in front of me, but there are dozens of children in our area that are in need of foster care and foster homes. And if you sit down, you take the time to sit down and get to know some of those children and some of their backgrounds, it just breaks your heart. And I was so blessed to have a mom and dad who loved and cared for me, and these kids deserve no less. And so you pray for the call ministry. Now, I've got some prayer cards here, and on this prayer card, it asks you to pray for the Higgins family, and it gives you some things, some specific ways that you can pray for them. And so if you'd be willing to take that family on, Bill and Christy, and Josh and Malachi, if you'd be willing to take that family on and remember them in prayer every day, and I want you to take a card. And listen, don't just take a card and walk out of here and not pray for them. Put it on your refrigerator, stick it in your Bible, put it on your mirror there, in your restroom as you're getting ready, whatever you need to do to remember this family in prayer every single day. Because they're going to need it, and I'm telling you, they will know it, and they will feel your prayers if you as a church body will pray. Not every church gets the privilege of having people in their church that is one-on-one, hands-on with them. So I'm so thankful for Bill and Christy and for their willingness to give their home to children that are not theirs and to make them theirs. And so we're so thankful and so proud of them. So we want to remember them in special prayer this morning. I asked Christy, I said, would you like to get up and say a few words? She said, I can. I said, but you would rather not. She said, right. So I'm speaking on her behalf, but we do need to remember them in our prayers. So we're going to do that today. I also want to ask that you remember one of our church members. And he does not know that I'm going to mention this, but Leon McLean is one of our new church members, and he's going to be leaving, I think it's a week from today. Is that right? On the 12th of November. To go to Senegal there in Africa. It's a ministry that he's been a part of before, prior to coming to our church. And so we want to remember him in special prayer this morning as well, as he will be leaving our country next Sunday, headed over to do the Lord's work. So we want to remember both of these in prayer today. So let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just stop and pause. And Father, we are so blessed to have homes and have a roof over our head and food on our table. And Father, there are so many in this room who would be very wealthy in other countries. And Father, we sometimes take that for granted. So Father, we want to pause and say thank you for all that you've blessed us with. And Father, we want to remember those who are in foster care in our area. And Father, for the dozens and dozens and dozens of children that the call ministry throughout our state has affected. And Father, we thank you for that ministry. We thank you for the call and for what it means to this state. And not only that, but Father, what it means all over the world and the way that it will impact the world through taking care of our foster children, our orphans here in Arkansas. Father, I personally thank you for the ministry in our county. Father, I know children that it has affected, and families and churches that it has affected. So, Father, I thank you for that. Father, we know that your word says that pure and undefiled religion is to take care of the widows and the orphans and their needs. And so, Father, this is one way that the church body in our state and in our county is doing that very thing. There's over 50 churches that are involved with the call ministry in our area. And so, Father, I thank you for those churches. Thank you for those Christian homes. And, Father, we specifically thank you for Bill and Christy and for their willingness to open up their home, these two young men. And, Father, we pray for Malachi and for Josh. And, Father, we pray that you would strengthen them in their family life, and, Father, also in their personal life. And, Father, if these two young men do not know you as Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that through this time in Bill and Christy's home that they would come to know you as personal Lord and as personal Savior. Father, if they do know you as personal Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that you strengthen their walk with you through their time here. Father, we're thankful for these two young men. And Father, I don't know all of their background, but you do. And Father, I thank you that you love them and that you care for them. I thank you that you are the Father to the fatherless. And Father, I pray that you help them see that. Father, we pray for all of the families in our church body that are connected with the call ministers. So many that help and serve and pray. And Father, we pray that you would continue to draw those out to help for the foster care needs in our county and our state. Father, I lift up Brother Leon to you and his trip to Africa. Father, I know what it's like. I know the spiritual warfare that I'm sure he is going through and will continue to go through this next week. There are things that will happen. So, Father, I pray that you would stay the enemy's hand from him and from his wife and from his home and from this trip. And, Father, I pray that you use him in a mighty, mighty way. Lord, I'm excited to hear of how you are working in Senegal through this ministry and to continue to get to know this ministry. Father, thank you for Brother Leon and for his willingness to go and to serve and to teach and to train there in the northwest region of Africa. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you so much for this day. Now, Father, we ask now, we've got a lot of things going on around this church. Father, I ask now that you would meet with us, and Father, that you would speak to our hearts, and Father, that you would change lives in this place. And it's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. Now, there's a lot of announcements there, but did I leave anything off that I should have announced? It's impressive. It's not impressive.
I'd like to thank everyone for the Chamber of Commerce, for the cookies and bars, dessert bars. Y'all came across great. I don't know how many dozen there was, but the table was so pretty, and people visited and ate. We may have had maybe two dozen. But there was one lady that visited, and she thought that like, this is a pretty nice flag. She took a picture and sent it to her friend, and her friend just texted back and said, "For me, the chili, come for the dessert."
When the ladies of this church are cooking, if they're cooking desserts, that's what I would say too. Forget the chili, go for the dessert. So thank you to everyone who made that a success. Stepping up to the plate, I know that's kind of out of our normal routine in the church body, so thank you for doing that. All right, anything else needs to be said or done? Celebrate Recovery tomorrow night, 5:45. Don't forget, happens every Monday night. They'd love to have you. If you have never come, they'd love to have you tomorrow. All right, if you are a guest with us, we want you to fill out that visit card that's there in the pew. Slip it into the offering plate as it comes around so we will know that you have been here to worship with us. When you stand and find someone and welcome you to service today.
Yeah. going to sing a song this morning about the grace of God. And it seems like anywhere I go, this is always somebody's favorite. This is your favorite this morning. I have it in here just for you. But man, what a wonderful message. Sing Grace Greater Than Our Sins.
Marvelous grace of our God. Yeah.
prepare this morning to take up our offering. I love that song, The Love of God. If we did devote ourselves every second of every day to declaring the love of God, then at the end of our lifetimes, it still wouldn't have even come close to showing the greatness of His love, the majesty of His love, the power of His love. And the best way for you to know that is to look back through your own life. I'm not going to do that. You can do that for yourself. I'll do that for me. Look back through your own life at all the moments you say, I wasn't real lovable right there. Wasn't real lovable right there. I got to go back about as far as this morning. Well, yep, messed up right there. Wasn't real lovable right there. God loved me through it. I didn't give Him a reason to. He loved me through it because His love is an awesome, awesome love. When I had children's church this morning for children ages 3 to kindergarten, I'll be dismissed to my right and to your left immediately after the offering this morning. Let's bow our heads and pray to that Father. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your love and we thank You for Your grace, Lord, as we have the privilege to sing about it this morning. I pray that You would receive honor and glory from everything that is said and done this morning, Lord. Bless the reading and the preaching of Your words. In Jesus' name, amen. I got up here this morning went to get this song ready, and I went to grab the CD. You ever lose anything in such a way that you've seen it in every place that you've been? And you think, oh, now I know where I put that. It was right there. And you go there, and it ain't there. And then, oh, now I remember where it was. And I was wrong every time. And scrounged around trying to find a CD that would work. Same song. The song has a beautiful message to it. I hope this song is good to each one.
The devil laughed and said, I've won. God has lost his only son.
Number five.
That's what I thought.
Right.
Four problems. I'm sorry.
That's what I pushed was number five. I queued it up on number five.
The brightest star no longer shines. Finally, this world is mine. Then he gathered all his demons near. He said, we have conquered love with fear. Meanwhile, back at the cross, all is not lost. Forgiveness is bought with each drop of his blood. Falls to the ground, mercy abounds as Mother Mary's tears fall down to see her precious son pay the cost. The devil said we'll use their pride, we'll attack them from inside, fill their hearts with vanity, till the differences are all they'll see. Black and white, rich and poor, to justify their holy war. Meanwhile, back at the cross, all is not lost. Forgiveness is born with each drop of his blood. It falls to the ground. But it's almost over now. Meanwhile, back at the cross, all is not lost. Forgiveness is born with each drop of his blood. It falls to the ground. Mercy abounds.
Judges chapter 11. Well, I have to say, it was worth the wait for that song. Amen?
Amen.
Great job, Paul. As always. As always. That's one of my favorites. Everything seems to be falling apart. But hey, meanwhile, back at the cross.
Amen.
Look at what Jesus has done for us. I want to talk to you this morning on the idea of an unlikely hero. An unlikely hero. Would you stand with me on the reading of God's Word? Judges chapter 11. Beginning in verse 1, the Bible says, Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a great warrior, but he was the son of a prostitute, and Gilead was his father. Gilead's wife bore him sons, and when they grew up, they drove Jephthah out and said to him, "You will have no inheritance in our father's house, because you are the son of another woman." So Jephthah fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob. Then some lawless men joined Jephthah and traveled with him. Sometime later, the Ammonites fought against Israel. When the Ammonites made war with Israel, the elders of Gilead went to get Jephthah from the land of Tob. They said to him, "Come, be our commander, and let's fight against the Ammonites." Jephthah replied to the elders of Gilead, "Didn't you hate me and drive me out from my father's house? Why then have you come to me now when you're in trouble?" Let's pray. Father, we love you. We praise you. Father, we thank you for this wonderful set of scriptures in the Old Testament. And Father, there's so many things to get from the truths that we're going to read and search into today. And Father, I pray that only those things that you'd have us to learn today would be a part of what we study. Father, you put your words in my mouth and your spirit in my heart. Father, you speak to our hearts, and Father, help us to be quiet, be still, and listen for your still, small voice. And Father, if you've spoken to hearts here today, Father, I pray that they come forward and that they would tell of the awesome thing that you have done in this place today. Father, every person here, I pray, will be saved when they leave this place today. You move, help us to listen, and be obedient. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. As an infant, this man was largely abandoned to a nanny. His mother, in fact, rarely saw him, and his dad almost never saw him. At 7 years old, he was sent to a boarding school where he proved to be literally the worst in the class. His parents got reports that declared that your son seems unable to learn anything. He was punished severely, once being dragged into a room and beaten into a bloody place because of some school infractions. He changed schools after his nanny discovered welts on his back from the beatings once he was home on break. He made no friends in school. His mom rarely visited him and even forgot to send him Christmas presents. His dad also failed to visit him at school ever, even when he was nearby and his son wrote letters asking him to stop by. His letters never were even answered. Dear Dad didn't even know exactly how old his son even was. During his teen years, his father wouldn't let him go to the best school, saying his son would just embarrass him, that he was such a stupid boy. He just couldn't accept that kind of public humiliation from what he said, and I'm leaving out a word, was an impudent little idiot. Again, in high school, he did not fare too well. As if to underscore the fact, on parent visitation days, while other kids' parents came to visit to see their children, he never came to see his son. The class would march out in rank order from highest score to the lowest. He was always dead last. His parents were embarrassed, so they stayed at home. He felt the sting of it as he said sharply, certainly a gross understatement. During his college life, he proudly wrote his dad to tell him that he had been accepted into military college. His dad finally wrote back, "You are a constant disappointment to me. Not only are you a complete failure, I see nothing ahead of you but failure. Do not write me anymore. I do not wish to hear anything from you." The same year, the son graduated from military college. His dad died in lingering pain and agony after being brought home in a straitjacket, perhaps reflecting the emotional straitjacket he had helped secure around his son's psyche for many relentless years. So, who is this failure son? Who was it that went nowhere and who never did anything? This loveless child, this imputable idiot, as his father so eloquently said. Who was this person? Well, he was a successful author of several books, one winning him the Nobel Prize, making him a very wealthy man. He was the lone voice in war, coming in the appeasement policies Neville Chamberlain brokered with Germany. He was made Prime Minister of England twice and presided over a successful war against the spread of Nazism. His name, Sir Winston Churchill. There's so many who have rough backgrounds and a rough past and who have maybe been told, possibly even in this room, that you're a nobody and you'll never amount to anything. I won't tell you I didn't grow up in a home like that, and I'm very blessed not to have grown up in a home like that. I'm very blessed that my parents never put any expectations on me on a football field or on a basketball court or on a baseball diamond. It was play to the best of your ability, give all you have, hustle. I heard that word a lot. Hustle. Boy, hustle. But I never heard anything about failure. I never heard anything in my life about missing a shot or not scoring a touchdown or missing a tackle. Never heard it. Though my dad, whenever I got into high school, the coach was looking up some statistics, and he led the school at that time. I don't know if he still does, in overall tackles in a single season and in a single game. He was all district and he was all state. I didn't even know that until I was about a junior in high school. I was out looking around in a well house. Now, some of y'all know what that is. You got to be cooks to know what a well house is. I was out in the well house, and I was looking for some things. It was a place where we stored some things, and I found all these trophies in a box. It was where my dad had won season after season after season. Not only that, he was offered a scholarship to play college baseball. I never heard that. I never knew that until I was in high school, and he began to tell me about his life and began to tell me about his athletic career. I'll never forget my high school coach. He was kind of a cut-up. Cooper Crail was his name. And Coach Cooper, whenever he looked at the statistics, and then he looked at me, and he looked back at the statistics, and he looked back at me, and he said, "What happened, son?" I said, "I don't know. I guess I got my genes from my mom. She was a cheerleader." Oh, man. I grew up in a good home. I don't know what it's like to be called a failure and all those things, but I will tell you, in my own life, I have felt like a failure many days of my life, so I can somewhat empathize with a man like Winston Churchill. And I can also look at Jephthah's life, and I can see where he was the son of a prostitute. I can see where he was the son of a nobody. As a matter of fact, it was worse than that. He was the son of a person that many in society would look down on, if not everyone in society would look down on. Certainly his family looked down on him. The Bible says that Gilead was his father, that Gilead had many sons, and they grew up together, and when Jephthah became of age, they drove him away. They literally run him out of town on rail. Why? Because his mother was a prostitute and he was a nobody. "You're a half-breed in our family. Get out of the family." Now, the Bible says that this man named Jephthah, who, by the way, is the one that we're going to focus in on today. Now, that's not true. The ultimate one we're going to focus in on is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? But the man that is a part of the study today is a man with an odd name, Jephthah. And he is the one we're going to look at. The Bible says that he was a mighty warrior. He was a man's man, but he was a nobody from Nowheresville. He was a man in the book of Judges. As we've been studying through the book of Judges, we see time after time that God uses some very obscure people, that God uses some people that the world would say are useless, but God raises them up. Now, we've skipped chapter 9 and chapter 10. And there's a lot in chapter 9 and chapter 10 in the book of Judges that we just simply won't have time to get to. But I guess the verses that sort of sum up chapter 9 and 10 is found in verse 6 of chapter 10. It says, "The Israelites again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. They worshipped the Baals and the Asherahs the gods of Aram, Sidon, Moab, and the gods of the Ammonites and the Philistines. They abandoned Yahweh and did not worship Him. Once again, God's people had went rogue. They are anti-Christ. They are anti-Jehovah. They are walking away the opposite direction in the way that Jehovah God would have them to go and follow. It's found throughout the book of Judges. The book of Judges does not get better. It just simply gets worse. Time after time after time, how God's people had abandoned the Lord. Now, I only have 2 points to the sermon, but don't get excited about only 2 points. That does not mean it's short. It just means I've stretched out 2 points further. All right? That's all that means. But point number one is this. Crying out when in need. Crying out when in need. God's people had driven out Jephthah. He was outside of the city. He was living in a land called Tob. He was living outside of the camp of the Israelites. Not only that, but he was keeping bad company. The Bible says some evil men joined company with Jephthah. And so he was running with a rough crowd and a rough place outside of God's kingdom. And frankly, I don't think Jephthah had any intention of ever going home. I mean, when your family drives you out, it's one thing to be driven out by the people, but his own family, his own brothers, drove him away and sent him away. And I figure he had just written that chapter of his life off and was going to move on and live life as Jephthah decided to live life outside of God's will and outside of God's kingdom. And then something happened. Something happened. We read about it there in Judges chapter 11. They became under bondage again. The Bible says that sometime later in verse 4, the Ammonites fought against Israel. When the Ammonites made war with Israel, the elders of Gilead went to Jephthah from the land of Tob, and they said, "Come and be our commander. If we are under bondage, we are dying, our sons are dying at war, and so we need someone to come and lead." Isn't it a shame that they had to drive Jephthah out just to go and get him to return because there was nobody in the camp to lead other than one man? You know, when the state of a whole nation rises and falls on the leadership of one man, that nation is in trouble. When the state of a church rises and falls just upon the leadership of the pastor, although I think the leadership of the pastor is important, but when it rises and falls just upon what the pastor can do and what he has been gifted to do, then that church is in trouble, in desperate trouble. Do you know there are things that happen every week in this church that I don't even show up to? There's no way to show up to everything that we do in our church. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. One person can't show up to everything. And so there are so many things that happen, things like grief share, that I rarely attend. And yet there are people who are gifted to lead out in grief share. There are people who are gifted to lead out and celebrate recovery. There are people who are gifted to lead Bible studies during the week that I don't attend, but I know God is doing some great things through those things. And, you know, it reminds me that if something ever happens to me, and I don't intend for anything to happen to me, and y'all be sure and appreciate me next week. Boy, that is the worst thing to stand up and say, "Now, Pastor Appreciation is next week as the pastor." So I said, "No, I don't want to do that." And I heard it. Y'all can do anything you choose to do, as long as it's positive and good, all right? I don't want any negative notes on Pastor Appreciation Sunday in my box, all right? And Roger doesn't need them. You can put all the negative ones to Paul. Paul McCartney. You spell that, capital M. Just kidding. I'm just being serious, y'all. So here's Jephthah. And they are dependent upon a man to lead them. They're dependent upon Jephthah. They go and they find him and they get him out. And here's what Jephthah says. And I love it because he is, man, the weight is on his shoulders. He is the one, the ball is in his court. And he turns to them and he says, "Wait a minute. You come to Tob, you get me out. And aren't you the same ones," he says in verse 7, "didn't you hate me? And didn't you drive me out from my own father's house?" He says, "Why have you come to me when you're in trouble?" Now listen, this is a direct illustration to what God's people had done with God himself. They had driven God out. They had said no to God. They had said no to his instruction. And they had driven God himself outside of the camp. This story is not about Jephthah. This story is about God and his people. And Jephthah says, "Now wait a minute, you hated me. Don't forget. It was just the other day you drove me out of this place. And I went and made a home somewhere else. You drove me out of my own father's house. You are my brothers, and you drove me out. My own kin, my own family wouldn't have anything to do. Don't you remember that? And now you've come and you're dragging me back home to lead you? Are you crazy? You're the ones who hate me. And now you want me to lead you out of bondage. Now you want me to lead you in war. Now you know what happens in war when you're the leader, you're at the front of the line. I mean, if you're a leader worth anything, right? And so Jephthah knows, man, I'm about to be at the front of the line. And when I call for backup, these knuckleheads who just threw me out are the ones I'm going to call for. Why are you calling me now? And you know, sometimes in our lives, I think God looks at us and says, why are you calling me now? You didn't have anything to do with me when life was good. You didn't have anything to do with me as long as I was putting food on the table and a roof over your head and everything was all right. Why are you calling me now? Aren't I the one that you have despised? You've not read my word. It's been weeks since you've read my word. Aren't I the one that you have despised? You've not spent a moment in prayer with me today. And now all of a sudden you're in trouble and you call out to me. I heard this illustration this week and it just went so good with my sermon that I stole it. But I'm going to give him credit for it. There's a guy named Mac Brunson. He's pastor of First Baptist Jacksonville, Florida. And he gave this illustration. I thought, man, that goes perfect with my sermon. I'm not even going to try to find a better one. That's good. And here's what he said. He said, in the Christian life today, most Christians are like someone in a hotel room with a do not disturb sign out on the door. You know what that do not disturb sign means? It means don't disturb me. I'm sleeping. I'm in the room. I don't want anyone else in the room with me. And he says, most Christians are like that. He says, God will disturb us to the point of salvation. And God will get us and drive us to the point of repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. And we want that because we all want to die and go to heaven. If I ask how many of you want to die and go to heaven, every hand in the room would be raised. No one wants to go to hell unless their mind's not right, right? I mean, it's kind of like the old man, the preacher gets up and says, how many of you want to go to heaven? And people raise their hand. This is an old corny joke. I'm just warning you ahead of time, right? You've already heard it. People raised their hand, and most of the congregation raised their hand, so he sees a few people hadn't raised their hand. He asked it again, how many of you want to go to heaven? We'll see a show of hands. And everyone in the room raised their hand other than one old man. He was sitting up on the second pew. And so he asked the old man, he said, sir, he said, I've asked everyone who wants to go to heaven. Everybody else has their hands raised. How come you don't have your hand raised? He said, you mean want to go one day or want to go 2 days? I thought you were getting up a van load to go right now. I'm not ready, but I'm prepared because of the blood of Jesus Christ. If you're prepared, you should say amen right there. It's a good place for one of those. Now, I'm thankful that I'm prepared to go to heaven. But there are many in the Christian life who have hung the do not disturb sign on their heart and said, you know what, you disturbed me enough to get me to heaven. Now, don't disturb me again. I'm happy living in this world. I'm happy living for the affairs of this life. I don't want any more disturbance in my life. Don't talk to me about lordship. Don't talk to me about following. Don't talk to me about discipleship. Don't talk to me about those things. I'm busy living my own life. I've got money in the bank. I've got money in the 401k. My business is doing good. My life is okay. My children are alive and taken care of. My church is good. I enjoy going to church. But I don't want anyone or anything to disturb me from my normal routine of life. Because I'm saved. I've checked that box. I've been baptized, just like the preacher said. Been baptized. I've done that. Now, I get the option to live my life however I want to. Because I believe in eternal security of the believer. Well, I'm going to tell you, I believe in eternal security of the believer as well. If you were here last week, you know that I preached and sort of tried to drive home the idea of eternal security of the believer. I believe in eternal life. I believe in eternal life beginning the moment that you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. You know why I believe that? It's not because I'm Baptist. It's because that's what the B-I-B-L-E says. And when I was a kid, my mom and dad used to teach me that the B-I-B-L-E, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the Word of God. B-I-B-L-E. And you know what? At a birthday this week, y'all, I'm getting old. My hair's leaving and it's turning color. Yeah. Wayne, that's the funniest thing you've ever said from that front pew. Wayne said, like fall. Yeah, but it doesn't turn back in the spring. It doesn't go back the other way. And you know what? I haven't changed yet. I'm still standing on God's word. And y'all, I'm telling you, I'm telling you, I know what I'm talking about. I'm not preaching something that I've read in the book. I'm preaching what I'm living. There are days in my life I just want to do my thing. I don't want to be disturbed. There are times in my life that I don't want to be the disturber. I see people who are living lives that are outside of God's will, and I just frankly want to pray for them and stay away. And as their pastor, I am called to step up to the plate and be the man of God who calls them back to a God who wants to let them to live a lifestyle of holiness. I heard a conversation this week in and around our church body, not necessarily church members, but in and around our church body, where someone says, you know what, doesn't God want me to be happy? My wife had come home and she was telling me about this certain conversation in a certain place, certain time. And I looked at her and said, God doesn't care if you're happy, he wants you to be holy. And you know, the sad thing is, most Christians miss that, that God wants us to be holy. God wants us to look more like him today than we did the day we got saved. And the sad fact is, a lot of us look more like Jesus the day we got saved than we do right now. And some of us have been saved some 30, 40, 50, 60 years, and yet we've not grown with Christ. You say, preacher, I didn't drive God away from me. Well, he didn't drive me away. You say, preacher, I didn't wake up one day and say, you know what, I think I'm just going to live life on my own without God. If you're a born-again Christian, you don't have that option. He has promised never to leave you, never to forsake you. And even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he will be with you. He is now your shepherd. He walks with you, and he'll talk with you if you allow him to. But if you grow cold and distant, he will continue to walk with you, and yet his judgment hand will be upon you. It's coming. It's just a part of life. When we move away from him, his blessing stays away, but his judgment must come. And as the Apostle Peter says in the New Testament, it's high time that the judgment of God begins at the house of God with his own people. You know, the Bible says that if we would just judge ourselves, God wouldn't have to judge us. If we would look at our own lives and we would say, now God, look, I know I have sinned in this area. And so I'm judging myself, and I'm coming before you, and I'm saying, God, forgive me for my sin and the things that I do that so upset you and so hurt your heart. And Father, I want to do more than that. I want to repent. I want to turn away from that sin. And God, I'm going to set up some boundaries and some parameters in my life that I'm just not going to be able to get across, so that I make sure and certain that I don't sin in that way again in my life. And we all know what happened. There's going to be times of weakness. There's going to be times of failure. Even in those things we say, we'd never do again. But how dare God's people say, God, forgive me, and then just walk right out of that forgiveness, right back into that sin. On and on and on. It's a perpetual circle. We go round and round we go. Where we stop, nobody knows. How far will God's people get away from their God? Well, in this day, they had driven Jephthah out. They had not only driven Jephthah out, but they had driven God himself out. Jesus talked about this in Matthew chapter 11, verses 7 through 19. Here's what he said. The Bible says that as these men went away, Jesus began to speak to the crowds about John. What did you go to the wilderness to see? A reed swaying in the wind? Or what did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothes? And certainly they didn't find that with John. This is John the Baptist, by the way. John the Baptist was in prison. He was about to give his life. He was about to lose his head for following Jesus. And so, at the moment of great conflict, as C.S. Lewis talked about, he goes and he sends some of his disciples to Jesus to ask Jesus, what in the world? Are you the Messiah? If you're not the Messiah, then I'm not giving my head for you. And so, Jesus tells his disciples in the verses before verse 7 in Matthew 11, go back and tell him everything that you've seen. Go back and tell him that the blind eyes are seeing and the lame legs are walking. Go back and tell him it's been a life change because I have been here. And as they were leaving, Jesus turned around to his disciples and he says, what did you come to see? What did you come to see when you went out in the wilderness? Did you go to see a reed swaying in the wind? Did you go to see a man who was dressed in soft clothes? He said, look, those who wear soft clothes are in king's palaces. But what did you go out to see? A prophet. Yes, I tell you, and far more than a prophet, this is the one it is written about. Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you. He will prepare your way before you. I assure you, among those born of women, no greater than John the Baptist has appeared. But the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. For From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been suffering violence, and the violent have been seizing it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied unto John, and if you're willing to accept it, he is the Elijah who is to come. Anyone who has ears should listen. He's talking about spiritual ears. And then he says in verse 16, to what should I compare this generation? It's like children sitting in the marketplace and call out to each other. We played the flute for you, but you didn't dance. We sang a song of lament, but you didn't mourn. For John did not come eating and drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. And here's what he said. He says, John came, and he didn't eat, and he didn't drink. He fasted and he stayed out in the wilderness and he wore rough clothing and he was a rough guy all around, but a prophet nonetheless. And you didn't like that. And now they put him in prison and they're about to take his head. And he says, now I come and I'm a little softer and I'm a little kinder at times, although there were those in his day who thought he was the second coming of Elijah. I've come and I've come eating and drinking and you call me a glutton and a drunkard. He says, you can't be pleased. He says, you're like children out in the marketplace who play the flute and yet nobody dances. In other words, you have checked the box, you've prayed the prayer, you've said the thing, and everything should be fine. God should be blessing me. Why aren't you blessing me? I'm playing the flute, and God, you're not dancing. Wow. What a statement. What a statement about God's own people. Now listen, he didn't say that outside somewhere. He said that right there in the heart of God's people. He looked at God's people, Israelites, and he told them, he says, you know, you played the flute and yet God's not dancing. And you're wondering what in the world's going on. He's saying that you have missed the best. You've missed the best. If someone asks you, are you a part of God's people? You tell them, yes, you live a moral lifestyle, but yet you have traded good for the best in life. A relationship. A walk with him. A time of prayer in which you would talk to God and yet God would talk back to you. Our God is not some cosmic bellhop somewhere who's waiting to jump at our every need. Listen, God wants us to learn what it's like to walk with him at all times so that in the bad times, in the tough times, in the hard times, you won't wander and stray, but you'll draw closer to him. Why? Because I'm walking with him every day of my life. And when the bad time comes, I'll know that God has been faithful to me thus far. How dare I turn back on him? So that I'll know that when I'm faced with spiritual battle, when I know there's spiritual warfare in my life and I recognize it and I see it, and I know that yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. My cup runs over. Why? Because I've been walking through the good times, so that I can stand through the hard times. When Jesus, right, by the way, I'm preaching a lot better than y'all, amen. I know I'm talking fast, but y'all are getting along, so I'm trying to go before y'all do, all right? So, if you look in, fast forward into the New Testament, right before the cross, there was only one disciple who went to the cross. All the rest fled. All the rest ran away. And that one disciple is also the same disciple that the Bible says that in the upper room, as the Lord's Supper, the Last Supper was going around, he was the only one who leaned on Jesus. John. What does that tell you? Man, when you got him and you're walking with him, and you can lean on him then, you can stand for him later. John's the only disciple who stood at the cross. John is the one, the only disciple. Out of the 11 that were left, he's the only disciple that Jesus had the privilege of speaking to from the cross. And he said, woman, your son, your mother. Can you imagine? Taking the place of the Messiah. Taking the place of Jesus here on earth with his earthly mother. Knowing that he's about to go, knowing that he's about to die, and I'm supposed to take care of her. How in the world would you do that? How in the world would you stand in the place of the Messiah? You stand in the place of the Messiah if you have leaned next to the Messiah. So here's Jephthah. They've called him out. They've asked him to come home. We want you to lead us. We want you to lead us. And he says, didn't you drive me out? Didn't you hate me? Didn't you want to have nothing to do with me? And so the Bible says in verse 8, they answered Jephthah. Since that's true, we now turn to you. Come with us, fight the Ammonites, and you become leader of the inhabitants of Gilead. So Jephthah said to them, if you are bringing me back to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gives them to me, I will be your leader. The elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, the Lord is our witness if we don't do as you say. So Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead. The people put him over themselves as leader and commander, and Jephthah repeated all his terms in the presence of the Lord at Mizpah. So he's come home, and he's going to lead. And so we have this great crying out when in need, and then we have a carrying out of a desperate promise. A carrying out of a desperate promise. The Bible says, skip over to verse 29. Down to verse 29 in Judges chapter 11. We just don't have time to get into everything. In verse 29 it says, the Spirit of the Lord came on Jephthah, who traveled through Gilead and Manasseh, and then through Mizpah of Gilead. He crossed over to the Ammonites from Mizpah of Gilead. Jephthah made this vow to the Lord. And by the way, anytime you see in Scripture where someone makes a vow to the Lord, you just need to automatically say, well, this may not be good. This may not be good. Be very careful making these flippant vows to the Lord. But Jephthah makes this vow. He says, if you'll hand over the Ammonites to me, whatever comes out of the doors of my house to greet me when I return in peace from the Ammonites will belong to the Lord, and I will offer it as a burnt offering. Here's what he should have said. The first animal that comes out of my house, I will offer as a burnt offering. But that's not what he says. And so the Bible says in verse 32, Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites to fight against them. The Lord handed them over to him. He defeated 20 of their cities with a great slaughter from Aurah all the way to the entrance of Manith and to Abel-Karamim. So the Ammonites were subdued before the Israelites. When Jephthah went to his home in Mizpah, there was his daughter coming out to meet him with tambourines and dancing. She was his only child. He had no other son or daughter besides her. When he saw her, he tore his clothes and said, no, not my daughter. You have devastated me. You have brought great misery on me. I have given my word to the Lord and cannot take it back. Then she said to him, my father, you have given your word to the Lord. Do to me as you have said, for the Lord brought vengeance on your enemies, the Ammonites. She also said to her father, let me do this one thing. Let me wander 2 months through the mountains with my friends and mourn my virginity. Go, he said. And he sent her away 2 months. So she left with her friends and mourned her virginity as she wandered through the mountains. At the end of the 2 months, she returned to her father, and he kept the vow he had made to her, about her, and she had never been intimate with a man. Now it became a custom in Israel that 4 days each year, the young women of Israel would commemorate the daughter of Jephthah, the Gileadite. Tough story to read as Christians, is it not? Though Jephthah was a great leader of the Israelites, no doubt, his name is later going to be mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to talk about that before we're done with the message. As a part of what some call God's Hall of Fame of Faith, he makes this flippant vow to God. Can you imagine? Can you imagine making a vow, whatever comes out of my tent first, that I will offer as a burnt offering to you, and leaving? No doubt he had in mind some animal would be the first one, a goat, a calf, something else would come out, but it was his daughter. The Bible says he had no other sons, he had no other daughters. Now that's important, because as she goes off for 2 months to wail her virginity, it is not just her virginity, but it is the fact that there will be no namesake for Jephthah. The family line and lineage will stop. It will end with Jephthah. In that day, it meant so much. It means a lot today in our society, in our culture, but it meant so much in that day to carry on the birthright and to carry on the bloodline. And so she goes for 2 months and she comes back and he carries out his vow. First off, I want you to see in this part of the story, don't make silly vows to the Lord. Don't make silly vows to the Lord. Don't get 36,000 feet in the air on an airplane and have a little turbulence and say, I'll preach when you get this plane down, if you get it down, Lord. And when God gets it down, you don't preach. Now, I know I'm probably the only one in this room who's ever done anything like that. God, if you'll just heal my father, if you'll just physically heal my father, then I'll do whatever. And you fill in the blank. And then God heals your father, and you totally forget about the vow. Don't make flippant, silly vows to God. Now, we serve a loving God. We serve a merciful God, and I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful that when I do stupid things like that, I can go to Him and ask for forgiveness. But the repercussions of the vow, once we make them to God, He's still very serious about our vows. If we've told God that we'll follow Him with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, He expects us to do that very thing when we make a vow to Him. So be very careful when you make a vow to God. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, 1 through 7 says, guard your steps when you go to the house of God. Better to draw near in obedience than to offer the sacrifice as fools do. For they ignorantly do wrong. Do not be hasty to speak. Baptist, do not be hasty to speak. The Bible says, do not be hasty to speak. In other words, there's times you need to keep your mouth shut. All right, moving on. And do not be impulsive to make speech before God. God is in heaven and you are on earth. So let your words be few. It bothers me to hear someone begin to pray and they just go on and on and on and on and on in their prayer. And sometimes very quick language. And just, it's almost like this vain repetition that Jesus talks about. Listen, let your words be few. Go before God. Tell Him you need. Go before Him in adoration and praise of who He is. But man, let your words be few. Tell Him what's on your heart. And then shut up and let Him speak to your heart. Let your words be few. Why? He's in heaven and you're on earth. You know what Solomon is trying to say in Ecclesiastes chapter 5? He knows all. And He doesn't need your commentary on what's going on. And if you need Him to work, you ask Him to work, and then back up and let Him tell you whether He's going to work, how He's going to work, and the changes that you need to make, because He's in heaven and you're on earth. Let your words be few. For dreams result from much work, and a fool's voice from many words. Verse 4 of Ecclesiastes 5. When you make a vow to God, don't delay fulfilling it, because He does not delight in fools. Fulfill what you vow. Better that you do not vow than that you vow and do not fulfill it. Do not let your mouth bring guilt on you. Do not let your mouth bring guilt on you. And do not say in the presence of the messenger that it was a mistake. Why should God be angry with your words and destroy the works of your hands? For many dreams bring futility. So do many words. Therefore, fear God. Wise words. But Jephthah's made the vow. It's out. His daughter comes and says, well, here's the vow I've made. I made it in the presence of God. She says, fulfill your vow. She goes for 2 months. She comes back. Now, here's where it gets mushy. You talk to Bible scholars, and there's some Bible scholars who will tell you, some Bible commentators that you read behind, they will say, now, Jephthah didn't actually offer her as a burnt offering. What Jephthah did is he offered her virginity as a burnt offering, that she would be a virgin for the rest of her life, and she would for the rest of her life wail over her virginity, not being able to carry on the bloodline. That's one line of thought. I'm not telling you it's right or wrong, I'm just telling you that's one line of thought. Most of those are very old school thoughts. And let me say what I mean by that. Most of those are thoughts from people who were around during the time of the church where everything had to be so neat and proper and prim, and you couldn't say that people made mistakes. I made the mistake of saying one time in the presence of a very elderly at that time, she's at home in heaven and no doubt she's saved, she was a great lady, but her husband was a Baptist preacher for years and years and years, and one in those cut and dry churches where everything's got to be neat and prim and proper and everything's just got to fit in a nice little box. And I got up and was preaching on Elijah.
But I didn't preach on his great victory. I preached on his great defeat as he was there and as he was going through a time of great depression. And I talked about how Elijah was a man just like anybody in this room. He had the same passions and desires as anybody in this room. By the way, I was quoting from the New Testament when I said that. And so at the end of the sermon, she came out and she said, "I want you to know I have a problem with your son." I didn't say it. I thought, "I want you to know, I don't care." But anyway, I did not say that. That would not be good. And I said, "Well, what in the world, Miss Sue, what in the world have I done?" And she told me, she said, "I want you to know that Elijah was a great man of God, and how dare you stand behind the pulpit and defame a great man of God." I said, "Look, I think he was a great man too. I can't call down fire from heaven. And I'm glad, but don't forget he did go through that bout of depression. It's right after a great victory. I mean, you got to do something with that. It's in the Bible." And she said, "Well, if you're ever going to preach a sermon like that on the great men of the Bible, then I'll just not show up. I will let you know." So here's what I believe really happened. I believe he offered her to burn off. I believe he killed his only daughter. You say, "Preacher, that's outside of God's will." Right. It is. Should he have done that? Certainly not. I mean, what moron would do something like that? I mean, this man is just, God's used him for a great defeat, and he comes home, and it's his daughter. What, I mean, a normal man that's following God would say, "Oh, God, I blew it. I didn't say animal. I should have said animal." And you go before God and you beg God's forgiveness. You offer a burnt offering, a sacrifice, and you get God's forgiveness. You just move on with life. You say, "Well, you know, God, I opened my mouth. I should have kept it shut. And I know it dishonors me, and I know it dishonors, but I am so sorry. I'm just going to have to be dishonored by my word, because I am not going to offer my wife, my daughter, as a burnt sacrifice. Not going to do that." And yet, I believe that's exactly what he did. You know why? He was so prideful that he could not let his own arrogance go to the side and say, "I messed up." But he would not break his word. He said, "Well, preacher, shouldn't that be uplifted that he wouldn't break his word? And I'll be men of their words." And you said, out of Ecclesiastes chapter 5, that you don't make these vain vows to God. When you make one, you need to follow through with it. So what you're saying is, if someone's in this room today, and they have been divorced, and they are remarried, and they read in God's word where you should not divorce and you should not remarry, that what they should do is get divorced to the one they're with now, to go back and try to make amends with the one they were at before, and so you take two wrongs and you try to make one right out of it. Is that what you're saying? Well, no. He shouldn't have killed her if he did. He blew it. And you say, "Now, wait a minute." You turn over to Hebrews chapter 11, and he is mentioned in God's Hall of Fame of Faith. I mean, right there with David, right there with Moses, right there with Abraham. That's exactly right. He is, because God colors best with broken crayons. Amen. If you look through that line and lineage, you look through that list. Well, let's just look through that list. You got Noah, who got drunk. You got Abraham, who had a child out of wedlock. You got Sarah, who told Abraham to have a child out of wedlock. And by the way, that's the reason we have all this mess between Islam and Christianity today, because he stepped outside of the confines of wedlock, and God will not hold that unaccountable. And Moses was a murderer. Rahab was a prostitute. Gideon was a coward. Samson was arrogant. David was a murderer, liar, and an adulterer. And on and on and on and on you can go. It's God's Hall of Fame of Faith. Do you know why they are in God's Hall of Fame of Faith? Because God's Hall of Fame of Faith is not about the people. It's about the faithful God of the people. Amen.
Amen.
Listen, you may be here today and you say, "Man, I'm just like Jephthah. I'm a nobody from nowhere still, and I have been thrown out by my family. My daddy told me I wasn't going to amount to anything, and boy, has he been right thus far." I want you to know we serve a God who loves those who are nobodies. I want you to know we serve a God who reaches down to the guttermost to save to the uttermost. Amen. I know that because I'm saved today. I know that because I'm born again today.
I know that God can reach down to the chief of sinners and set him his feet upon a solid rock of Jesus Christ if he'll turn to him in repentance and faith. I know that not because I read it in a book, but because I've lived it in my life. I know that God can save anybody here. I know it doesn't matter where you come from. I know it doesn't matter what you've done. I know it doesn't matter about your past. But God can take a man and make him unlikely, but make him a hero in God's timeline if you'll so choose to trust him. You may be here, you may not have one. You may not have a mother and father. This last week, I got a phone call of a guy who was traveling through, and I asked him where his home was. He said, "I don't have one." He said, "I'm home." I asked him who his father was. He said, "I don't have one. I'm fatherless." Now, we all know he's got one somewhere, but he didn't know who he was. It didn't have anything to do with him. He said, "My father has nothing to do with me." I said, "I've got great news. I serve a God who is a father to the fatherless. He'll step in and fulfill that role that your dad had." And had a great conversation with him. He later on told me that he'd been born again, that he had trusted Jesus as his personal Lord and Savior. He said, "I'm outside of his will right now, but I know it." And I said, "Well, amen." I got to pray with him, and we parted company. Where are you? Is God calling you to do something? And yet you told him no. I'm telling you, he used you. He used you. He said, "Preacher, you just don't know." How many times have I heard someone say, "You just don't know what I've done." And I look back and think, "You just don't know what I've done." Because, brother, if you want to write a book, I can put a few chapters in it. If you want to write a history of God using somebody who knows. My second sermon, my second sermon, almost every person I went to high school with showed up. And I asked one of the girls after the sermon, I said, "What are y'all doing showing up? Half of y'all didn't go to church." They said, "We just want to come and see, was it real? God, had God really called Doug Enzer to preach?" Yep, can God use somebody who was born son of a prostitute? Yep, I believe. Turn over to the New Testament, Brother Doug, and read where I'm in the Hall of Fame of Faith. Yes, sir. Jephthah, did you make a lot of mistakes? I did, but he never did. David, can God use someone who makes mistakes? Have you read of the story of Bathsheba? Yes, God can use someone who makes mistakes. Have you ever read the story of my son Absalom, who tried to kill me and overrun my throne? Have you ever read about my family? Yeah, God can use someone who's made mistakes. What about you, Noah? Can God use someone who made mistakes? Well, we put the planet back together after I got drunk that night. Yeah, God can use people who make mistakes. That was Ryan, by the way. It was time for him to get up. Not real sure where he was going, but it was time for him to get up. Listen, he said, "What am I going to learn from Jephthah? If you're not saved, you can be saved. You can be saved. If you repent of your sins and turn to Jesus, you'll be saved from that. Doesn't matter your past. If you are saved, you can be used. You can be used." They said, "Preacher, you just don't know." I don't have to know. God does, and yet he, by his own free will and choice and his sovereign hand, chooses you. Chooses to use you. And I'll be honest, I look in my own mirror and say, "Lord, what were you thinking? Look at this failure that I looked at every day. How dare you?" I mean, there's so many people out there that you could use in a different way. So many other people could be the pastor of that church and preach on Sundays, and then God has chosen me. And it's not about me. It's about him. It's about his honor and his glory. So where are you today? Take you down to use you. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. We have a time of invitation. If God spoke into your heart, I just pray that you come. Talk to. Maybe there's a public declaration of your faith that you need to make today. Maybe you've been saved, but you've never told anyone about it. So today's your day. Step forward and say, "I need to tell everyone that I've been born again." Maybe you're here today and you say, "Preacher, if I die, I'm not going to heaven." I know I'm not going to heaven because of the life that I've lived and the things that I've done. You may not be now, but you can be before this invitation is over. You can trust Jesus right where you are. He could repent of those sins, and that means to turn away from those sins and turn to Jesus. You could turn around and begin to walk in a different direction to follow after Him, but it's a choice you have to make. It's a decision that you have to make, and you can make it right now. Just pray to Him and say, Lord, I trust You with all my heart. I'm asking You to be my Lord and my Savior. I want to repent of my sins and turn to You. I don't want to die and go to hell. I want to die and go to heaven. And I'm asking You right now, Lord Jesus, to come into my heart. I believe that You died on the cross, and I believe that on the third day You arose from the dead. And I believe that by faith right now. Listen, if you pray a prayer like that this morning, it's my prayer that you come forward. And you tell God and you tell this church that you mean business with your decision to trust Him. Man, why are you floating out there when God wants to set your feet solid on the rock of Jesus? See, preacher, you don't know what I'm doing. You don't have to. He does. He chooses you this morning. Maybe you're here today and you know Jesus, but you've been away from Him. I want to tell you, He's the God of forgiveness. He wants you back. He wants you to come home today. I don't know what God's moving on your heart. I just pray if He is, that you'd answer and say yes. Father, we love You. We praise You. Thank You so much for this day. Father, may everything that we do in this church in all times be for You and for Your honor and for Your glory. But Father, especially at this moment, during invitation time, Father, You move in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand. As we sing,
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice, the same old lies, trying to fill the same old holes in the sky. There's a better life. There's a better life. Got pain, pain taker. Feel lost, need a way maker. You need freedom, a savior. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light.
Take your new if you allow it. All right, we're going to have worship tonight at 6 o'clock. Everybody's going to come back. I know we're going to have everybody here plus a few more. I'm coming, so I hope you are too. Hope you come back and worship with us tonight if at all possible. Now listen, if you had signed up to go to Africa back in the summer, that fell through. You know that fell through, but we are planning to still go this spring. We're going to have our first meeting again. And we're going to look Satan right in the face and say, here we are again. And we're going to try it again. So tonight, right after the evening worship, I want you to come and be a part of that, and we'll begin to make some plans coming up for this spring. Again, it's tonight, right after evening worship. You should have gotten a call out about it on that team. So I hope you did. Hope you can come and meet with us. If you can, please let me know so I will know. I still want to be a part of it and keep my name down. I've already heard from a couple who are going to be working. But if you're able to come, please come tonight after worship. All right, so anything else needs to be said or done before we dismiss? Good. Thanks for listening to me. Quite a while this morning. I appreciate that. Everybody stayed with me. It went a little longer than normal, but I appreciate that. Come back tonight, and I'm sure God will give us a real short message. I promise you this, it'll be delivered by a short guy, all right? Brother Matthew Keith, can you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please? Hey, before you're dismissed, one announcement that I didn't make. The kids are at the doors. They've got buckets there. If you put your chain down your pocket, into those buckets it goes to pay for postage for the Operation Christmas Child.